Hello from Manila, where more than 70 participants from more than 20 countries have gathered for the first International Solidarity Conference on the Rights of Climate Migrants, organized by Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung Foundation. Today we are in conversation with Annesley Morejon. How do you pronounce your name?
Morejon.
Annesley Morejon from the Ministry of Science, Technology and Environment. Annesley is more very conversant in English, but still she feels she's more conversant in Spanish. So we have taken the services of Stephen. He has graciously agreed to be the translator for this video interview. So thank you, Stephen, for that. Annesley, will you please share how Cuba is dealing with the situation of climate migrants?
La pregunta es que cómo están trabajando con el tema de la migración y del clima, del medio ambiente.
Cuba tiene una política de enfrentamiento al cambio climático muy fuerte, porque tenemos una gran voluntad, el gobierno tiene una gran voluntad política para enfrentar este gran problema ambiental, que es un desafío.
Yo hablo después de otro.
Es un gran desafío. Cuba, como es una isla, tenemos muchos estudios que muestran cómo va a ir subiendo el nivel del mar, y esto va a producir migraciones dentro del propio país. Pero como la política del gobierno es dignificar la vida del ser humano, el gobierno no deja a nadie desamparado. Por eso se han trazado planes para relocalizar las comunidades en lugares geográficamente seguros, pero estas comunidades van a contar con todos los servicios que tienen actualmente: servicios de agua, de electricidad, de educación, porque la política es dignificar la vida humana.
So the Cuban government has a state policy and project of uplifting the human dignity of people in the Cuban society. And given the conditions of climate change, they recognize that there will be internal displacement, because Cuba being an island and the rising sea levels, they recognize that there will be internal displacement in the country. But because of that, they've created a lot of research and investigations in the conditions of the people of the country to respond to this climate change. And one thing that they're starting to respond to is starting to draft a plan and create a plan of action in relocating the people that will be displaced potentially due to climate change in the country. Because again, like I said, they've recognized through their research that there will be internal migration in the country. So that's one way that they're responding, by doing the investigation of the rising sea levels around the island, and making sure that once people have to move, that they will have all the needs that they currently have given to them: access to education, access to healthcare, access to the basic needs that they might have. So instead of seeing them as climate refugees, but seeing them as Cuban citizens, and still responding to the conditions with dignity and solidarity.
Which means that the people there have actually not faced any problems due to climate change, means due to migration arising out of climate change. Is that true?
Así que la gente no ha sentido todavía el impacto del clima.
En algunos asentamientos sí se ha sentido el impacto del clima, que ha empezado a subir el nivel del mar. Y los problemas ambientales que teníamos, tenemos una estrategia ambiental que identifica todos los problemas ambientales, y los problemas ambientales se han ido intensificando: la desertificación, la escasez de agua. Y sí hemos ido sintiendo en muchas comunidades que la escasez de agua, sí se siente la escasez del agua, y tenemos que abastecerlos con servicios de, no sé, pipa, no sé si se...
¿Pipa?
Transportar de water el agua en carros a las comunidades. Es decir, ya hemos ido sintiendo los efectos del cambio climático.
Again, given this, the rising sea levels, people have been affected by the climate change specifically in the coastal areas. And one thing that they've also experienced is the lack of water, the droughts in those coastal areas. So one thing that the Cuban government has responded to is either by taking water to them, whether they're driving it into the these communities. But that's one major thing, right? The access to water, right? Acceso al agua, sí. The access to water, clean drinking water, that potable water, right? So that's one level, one experience, right? Because again, the rising sea level in the coastal area. But the Cuban government has responded to support the people there.
I have heard Cuba has been helping climate migrants from other countries also and neighboring countries. How is it trying to mitigate the suffering of migrants from other countries?
Ha oído ella que Cuba ha apoyado a otros migrantes de otros países.
¿Se los ha recibido?
No, no sé si los ha recibido, pero ha apoyado a otros países en esos temas de sus migraciones. ¿Ha pasado eso?
Cuba ha apoyado a los países cuando lo necesitan. El apoyo fundamental ha sido cuando en el área del Caribe, que eran muy afectadas por los huracanes, y las personas tienen problemas, se incrementan las enfermedades. Cuba apoya en esas situaciones de desastres por el surgimiento de enfermedades, personas que han sido desplazadas, ha apoyado en la construcción de viviendas, en programas de educación. En esos momentos de desastre, Cuba ha apoyado sobre todo el área del Caribe.
So the way that Cuba supported the conditions of climate refugees is not necessarily by accepting them in the country, but by supporting the countries that have been faced climate change in the Caribbean, specifically when there's been hurricanes, right? Cuban government has sent doctors, has sent supportive infrastructure to building homes, medicine. That's one way that the Cuban government has provided support in the impact of climate change in the Caribbean by sending the resources that they have, whether it be doctors, medicine, or infrastructure, to build infrastructure, homes, and whatnot.
Okay, in fact, my next question was around the very robust public health system which Cuba has. I'm very impressed by that. So how is that helping Cuba to deal with climate migrants in its own country and also in providing help to other countries?
Ahora que quiere hablar sobre el tema de la salud pública, que ha oído que es muy muy importante la salud pública en Cuba, ¿cómo han usado la salud pública para ayudar a gente que está afectada por el clima en Cuba y en
fuera de Cuba? Nosotros tenemos un fuerte sistema de salud en Cuba. Que se divide en diferentes niveles de atención. Tenemos la atención primaria, que se conoce como un médico que está en una cuadra y atiende a las casas alrededor. Después una atención secundaria, que es como una pequeña clínica, que llegan los casos de urgencia o también llegan personas que necesitan fisioterapia, vasculares, las enfermedades ortopédicas. Tenemos diferentes hospitales, los pediátricos, y tenemos un programa de higiene y epidemiología. Con el cambio climático suben las temperaturas, aumentan las lluvias y con eso aumentan los vectores como el mosquito y aumenta el dengue, el nivel de dengue. Hay todo un plan, hay toda una estrategia que tiene el gobierno cubano, que es una campaña que se llama Al mosquito no lo dejen volar, que significa que cuando empieza la época de lluvia y empieza la época de lluvia, como hay mucho calor, el mosquito comienza a desarrollarse y empieza toda una campaña de fumigar casa por casa durante todos los días para matar al mosquito, para que no se reproduzca el mosquito Aedes aegyptis. Y también el médico de la familia, que es la primera atención que recibimos, visita todas las casas preguntando si alguien tiene fiebre, si alguien se siente mal, y si alguien tiene esos síntomas, es remitido y hospitalizado para realizarle análisis y para recibir atención médica. Este mismo protocolo es el que lleva a Cuba a otros países. Es decir, la atención primaria de la salud, la secundaria y el apoyo de los especialistas, ya sea en un hospital. Y también educamos en esta prevención de las enfermedades que proliferan con cuando suben las temperaturas como el dengue.
So the question of health in Cuba, they have a multifaceted health system. At the first level is the primary care, where it's the house visits. So they have in every part of the city or part of the country have specific doctors that are visiting their homes at a date at when it's needed, right? Once if they need more than the house visit, they have what they call the polyclinics. And the polyclinics is what provide the primary care as well, whether it be physical therapy or just a physical checkup or a cold or a flu. That's they go to the polyclinics. If at the polyclinic they need more than the polyclinics, where they have the hospitals, whether it be the surgery or the more emphasis and support there, right? And then aside from that, then they have the research institutes that then are more focused on certain issues. When it comes to climate change, they also have a center of epidemiology. In this center, what it focuses on is research centers. It's focusing on given the climate change of the rise of heat, the extensive heat and the amount of rain, you have dengue, you have mosquitoes. So their project is to focus on that part, right? They have a campaign on eliminating the amount of mosquitoes that come about because of these issues. And this campaign that goes house to house and fumigates the house. So once they started seeing an increase of mosquitoes, every day they go and fumigate the houses. And it works at the multiple levels where this epidemiology research center does this, but then the day-to-day doctor visits the homes to check on the patient, the people there, to see if they've gotten infected by anything or gotten sick or how's the situation with the mosquitoes. And so this model that they have is what they take to other countries to show them and explain to them how they do it. When asked, of course, how they do this model, and give the resources, the tools that may be needed to implement this model.
So, what do other countries need to do? All countries need to do to reduce the risk perception for impact of climate change on migrants, and also for better management of climate migrants. What is Cuba's advice to other countries?
Consejo
para que reduzcan
para apoyar a los inmigrantes del clima y también el consejo de Cuba para el mundo en cómo.
Ah, lo mismo que dijo ahorita.
El éxito de Cuba ha estado en la educación del pueblo cubano. Ha sido una política a lo largo de los 62 años de la revolución. Una política fuerte de educación en todos los temas. Y estos temas de cambio climático y toda la crisis ambiental es muy priorizada en nuestro país. Damos programas un programa que se conoce como Universidad para Todos, que son clases de profesores, de prestigiosos profesores universitarios sobre el tema ambiental, sobre el cambio climático, sobre todo lo que debemos hacer para enfrentar el cambio climático. Y también es todo el apoyo del gobierno, ¿no? Para cuando pasa un evento meteorológico, que no haya pérdidas de vidas humanas, que no haya pérdidas de vidas materiales. Pero en el caso de que haya pérdidas, hay una gran respuesta por parte del gobierno, que vuelven a construir las viviendas, vuelven a reconstruir, ¿no?, los asentamientos humanos. Y eso es un gran apoyo, y por eso creo que la revolución se ha mantenido durante estos 62 años, a pesar de las condiciones, ¿no?, que tenemos por el bloqueo norteamericano. ¿Cuál es el mensaje de Cuba para el mundo para enfrentar esta crisis, que es una crisis ambiental, ¿no?, provocada por un sistema que pone en primer lugar el capital y en último lugar la naturaleza y el ser humano? Creo que lo más importante es lograr una articulación con los movimientos sociales, y que estos movimientos sociales generen un pensamiento crítico que genere una contrahegemonía, que las personas en las comunidades se articulen y de ellos mismos generen proyectos para mejorar sus condiciones de vida. Porque si se sientan a esperar que un gobierno los ayude, la ayuda no va a llegar, o va a llegar muy poca ayuda. Entonces, una de las... Una de las de los mensajes que quiere transmitir Cuba es educación, más educación, más educación, pero una educación que enseñe a las personas a pensar y que enseñe que las personas pueden hacer y pueden generar proyectos y no tienen que esperar a que venga un gobierno, ni venga las Naciones Unidas, ni venga ningún programa a intervenir y a darles ayuda, sino que las propias personas con sus esfuerzos y con la integración y con el apoyo de los movimientos sociales que existen, con los movimientos de izquierda, los ayuden a mejorar las condiciones, porque el cambio climático, cada vez la situación va a empeorar. Entonces las personas tienen que crear alianzas para enfrentar y no esperar a que venga una ONG a ayudarlos, porque si viene la ONG es para buscar beneficios.
So she's one thing that's very important she said to remember is that the success of the Cuban Revolution and the 60 years that it's been successful has been the education of the people. And educating the people on their needs and educating the people on through a very critical and counter-hegemonic perspective of the conditions that they face. And so for them, as the Cuban society, that's been the element that's kept them going as far as providing education on the environment and education on climate change. They have a program called University for All, where they bring professors and researchers that focus on the environment, that focus on climate change, and provide classes to anyone that wants them, right? That's outside of the university, to get people to understand what's happening around them, right? So for people outside of Cuba that are dealing with a system that places profits over people, over the earth, or in her words, capital over people and the earth, she says that what's most important is that we need to focus on how social movements and people on the ground can counter and produce this education that she's talking about in Cuba, that the social movements and the people are the ones that need to create this critical counter-hegemonic education that challenges this system that she's talking about, the system that places capital over people. And that we need to rely more on the social movements and the people on the ground to create those conditions, to create the ability to challenge what's happening in the world, because if we wait for NGOs, if we wait for the United Nations, if we wait for governments that places profits over people, we're never going to get there. That we need to really focus on emphasizing the strength of social movements and building people power on the ground to challenge what we're seeing in the current moment.
So basically strengthening the education sector and the health sector are very important parts.
Yeah. Exactly. And so and reminding ourselves the importance of leftist social movements, movements that are anti-systemic, that are counter-hegemonic, to provide these things that you just mentioned. And to help people to think, right? The people need to think about what's going on around them.
One last question. Does climate migration impact women differently, or is the effect same on men and women who are displaced?
Los últimos estudios que hemos hecho en Cuba, que son las comunicaciones, es decir, que se analizan toda la situación de Cuba y con las medidas a tomar, se ha tenido en cuenta transversalizar con enfoque de género, se ha tenido en cuenta la mujer y sí afecta más a la mujer, porque en Cuba se mantienen los roles patriarcales de la mujer es la encargada del sustento de la familia, la mujer es la que corta, en las zonas rurales la mujer es la que corta la leña, la mujer es la encargada de cuidar los hijos. Actualmente hay muchas, no existe la familia tradicional cubana, la familia, es decir, el concepto de familia tradicional, sino son familias extendidas, y a veces en una casa lo que hay es un matriarcado. Por ejemplo, en mi casa somos un matriarcado. Entonces, sí afecta, va a afectar más a la mujer, porque la mujer continúa en el rol de ser la encargada de sostener a toda la familia, de cocinar, de lavar la ropa, de mantener. Entonces, si hay afectaciones con el agua, si hay afectaciones con la comida, si se le dificulta para cocinar, sí, la mujer va a ser más afectada. Y eso se ha tenido en cuenta en los estudios que se han hecho sobre la adaptación al cambio climático en Cuba.
So the current research that's being conducted on climate change in the environment in Cuba, that they're participating in, have had a gendered lens, and this gendered research that they focus on has shown that it has a lot more of an impact on women, and specifically in Cuba, when she's talking about Cuba, is that given that the certain conditions in Cuba that still maintain patriarchal values that are currently being challenged, the roles of women that have to do the reproductive labor of the home, the caring of the children. All these day-to-day activities will be impacted if there's lack of water, if there's lack of food. And there's a lot of homes also that are led by women, the matriarchal households in Cuba, that also if the woman's leaving a home but there's lacks of access to water, lack access to food because of the changes in the environment, this will create more problems for women to maintain their families.
Well, that was the last question from me. But would you like to share anything beyond what I have asked? Anything you want to share or give a message
about? Quisiera decir que quisiera compartir un mensaje optimista, ¿no? Porque no todo puede ser negativo. Estamos a tiempo de hacer grandes cosas, de subvertir el sistema, de cambiar el sistema, de generar contrahegemonía, pero nos tenemos que unir porque somos la mayoría. La minoría son los poderosos que nos han hecho creer que son los más, pero la mayoría somos nosotros. Si nosotros logramos una integración poco a poco, que es difícil, podremos lograr grandes cosas, y ese es el mensaje que quiero dejar.
So she wants to end with an optimist lens rather than not everything has to be looked bad, especially where we're in this conference right now. But she wants to remind the people that that we have to unite. We have to be united in a common vision, because as she just said, is that those in power want us to feel that we're the minority, but we are the majority. The majority are the people, not those in power. As much as they want to say that they have all the power, it's all of us that have the power, and that we're the majority of the people globally. But we have to unite, because we can change the system. We're still in time to subvert the system and create an alternative system that will be for the people, she says. But that only happen if we're all united. And it's going to take time, but it will take time to build a stronger movement against the system, a counter-hegemonic movement against the system.
Thank you, honestly, and thank you, Stephen, for being there. We were in conversation with Anisle from the Ministry of Science, Technology and Environment, Cuba, on site from the first International Solidarity Conference on the Rights of Climate Migrants, organized by Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung Foundation. And Stephen was there to help us with the translation.
I did the best that I could.
This conference is being live streamed at www.climatemigrationforum.net, and be welcome to follow the hashtags Beyond Labels, Beyond Borders and Climate Migrants Rights Now. Thank you.